All right, any questions before we get started today? Any questions? Sorry. All right, well, today we're going to talk about Markov decision processes. And whenever you hear those words, what you should think is non-deterministic search. Okay, so MDPs, though they sound like something totally new, are in fact just a kind of search where the outcomes of your actions are uncertain. So, why might you have non-deterministic search? Well, in the real world, you can choose the actions you take, but you can't choose how they'll actually play out in the world. So for example, if you're this robot here and you're kind of skirting the edge of the cliff to get the gem, well, you can choose to move towards the gem, but you don't actually control whether or not the cliff is going to collapse and you're going to fall to your fiery death. So in this case, we would think of the choice to move rightward as an action. You control that. And the outcome, whether you reach the gem or fall to your fiery death, that's the outcome of the action, which you don't control. Now, even though you don't control it, you'll be able to place a probability distribution over it. So a lot of this machinery we've seen from Expectomax will be very relevant here. We're going to have a couple examples of Markov decision processes, or MDPs, as we'll call them for short. The first example is going to be a grid world, so it's kind of going to be a maze again, like our search example, which was a maze. But we'll see other examples that aren't maze-like. So let's just first think about this maze-like problem. In this problem, the agent lives in a grid, okay, and here's a 4x3 grid. This is actually the same grid if you're following in the Russell and Norvig book. If you're using that, they use this exact same grid here, so you can line everything up. The agent lives in a grid, and there are various walls. So here, that kind of light gray area is a wall. And you want to move around. The problem is your movements do not always go according to plan. So in terms of actions, you always have the choice of moving north, south, east, or west. That's your action. Whether or not you actually move one square north or east or west is not entirely under your control. So the rules, okay, and you only really need the fine print when you go to work out an example. The rules are that 80% of the time, the action does what it's kind of meant to do. So 80% of the time, if you choose the action north, you actually move one square north. 10% of the time, the action goes at a right angle clockwise. And 10% of the time, it goes at a right angle counterclockwise. So in the case of north, 10% of the time, you actually go west instead. And 10% of the time, you go east. You can't actually directly stay in place or slip backwards in this grid world, though you can make up your own grid world where the details were a little different. Okay. There's one complexity, which is once you resolve this 80-10-10 thing, if that direction would result in hitting a wall, then you stay put. So for example, if you are where this robot is right now and you choose south, 80% of the time you'll go south, but going south means staying where you are. Okay? So we'll come to know and love this grid world, but you get the basic idea. You have directions, but sometimes your actions don't actually move you in that direction. Now, of course, if you're in a grid world, you should have something you're trying to achieve, right? And in a search, we might have been trying to get to the goal, right, which might have been the closest dot or something like that in Pac-Man. In this case, what you're trying to achieve involves rewards, which come at every step. And in this particular grid world, we're going to break rewards up into two kinds. There's a big reward that comes at the end of the game. So in this particular case, if you get to the gem, you will receive a reward of +1 when you choose the action exit on that square. If you get to the fiery pit of death, then you'll get a -1 when you choose the action exit from that square. In addition to this big reward, positive or negative at the end, you also get a little reward that we'll call a living reward at each step. And this could be positive or negative. This is a little bit of bonus or a little bit of cost that you incur every step when you just take an arbitrary move. Now, there's nothing special about living rewards or a big reward at the end or anything like that. That's grid world. Other MDPs don't have that. But this is grid world here. And so basically, your goal is to move around, right? And you'd like to eventually get to that +1 in general. And you'd like to do it relatively quickly if you have a negative living reward because kind of your bank account's ticking downward every time step. And you'd like to avoid the fiery pit of death as you do it. So these are the kinds of things that this agent will be thinking about when it computes its actions. So what's the goal? The goal is to maximize your sum of rewards. There's some fine print here, we'll come back to that. But for now, just imagine that points are, just like Pac-Man, their score. And plus one is a good score, and minus 0.02 for a living reward is bad. And you'd like to get kind of the largest sum of rewards that you can. So in a deterministic grid world, which would be just a maze, right, you have actions like go north. And they have one result. The result is you are now one unit north on the grid. So actions are really simple. And when we did search, this is how the actions worked. Right? You knew what your actions were. You knew exactly what they did. And we thought about a successor function, which told you from your current state what successor states you can get to. And you can pick among them, right? You can guarantee any of those successors. In an MDP, you can think of this as just the same kind of thing, but with some noise in your actions. So you can still choose to take the action north, but now you don't know what's going to happen. Probably, and according to these grid world rules, that means kind of with 80% chance you will actually move north. But there's a 10% chance you'll actually end up slipping and moving right, and there's a 10% chance you'll end up slipping and moving left, which in this case is fire pit of death. Okay? So it's still the same set of, you saw this notion of states and actions, but now actions have multiple possible results. And we're going to need to change our search formulation to kind of unpack that successor function in a way that lets us talk about what the possible results are and how likely they are. Let's formally describe a Markov decision process. Right? So a Markov decision process formally is described by a set of states just like search. So these states, it's just like the search states. A set of actions. And these are just like search too, except we typically, in the formalization, we just said states have successors. But if you remember in your project one, each successor actually comes along with an action, which you'd need to, for example, compute the sequence of actions that constitute the solution. So we have states and actions just like in search. Now, all this other stuff is a little bit different. So all the stuff here is, in essence, the successor function, but unpacked with a lot of notation. And it's very important in this unit that we not go into symbol shock, because you're going to be seeing these same kinds of transition functions and states and successors and actions. You're going to see these things over and over and over again. And it's very easy to kind of glaze over. But it's really important because we're going to be building on these concepts in the next probably four lectures. Okay, so what does the successor function look now? Well, there's now a transition function here. What a transition function says is from state S, which is your current state, and choosing action A, which is under your control, there are multiple possible S primes that could result. In single agent deterministic search, there was one possible result S prime. Now there are lots. And so what we have is we have a function which tells us for any S prime how likely it is to result. Okay, so you plug in an S, you plug in an A, that's your state and action pair. And then you can try lots of different S primes. Some of them will have probability zero, perhaps. That means they can't happen. Other ones will have non-zero probability. That means they might happen. And if one of them has probability one, it means it's actually deterministic after all. So that's your transition function. Another way to think about TSAS prime is as a conditional probability, if this is clear for some people. In other words, TSAS prime is the probability, given that you're in state S and take action A, that your result state will be S prime. So this is a distribution over S primes. Right, that's the transition function. It tells you the things that might happen and how likely they are. Then you have a reward function. In search, remember we had costs, right? But each action had a cost associated with it. Well, now the cost is going to depend on what happens. So, for example, in that last case where you might fall into the pit of death, maybe you want the cost to be high if you fall into the pit of death, but low if you don't. Right? So you can't just say how much an action costs until you see what happens. Therefore, we have a cost function, or now it's called a reward function, which is R of SAS prime. This says if you're in state S and you take action A, and the outcome that happens is S prime, how many points will you get? Costs in search were bad, right? You always wanted to minimize costs, right? So, but now we're in this framework of maximizing expected utilities. And so rewards are essentially negative costs. Rewards are good. So instead of minimizing costs, we maximize rewards, and so the sign has changed. But the reward function is really just the cost function in disguise. Okay, states, actions, transition function tells you what might happen, and the reward function tells you how much it will cost if it does happen. Typically, then, there's a start state, and sometimes there's a terminal state. a lot of the math works out nicely when there's a terminal state, but there doesn't have to be one. So for example, in grid world, we might imagine that there's an extra state that you don't see called done. Like that there. And done kind of works out. You get there from the states that end the game. Okay? All right. So MDPs are essentially non-deterministic search problems. Let's see one in action. All right, so this is that same grid, and you can ignore the zeros for now. For now, just black means it's a square I can traverse. Gray means it's a wall, so I can't move into that square. And the double squares are these special states. They're not actually terminal states. They're states from which you have only one action available. That action is called exit, and when you take it, you're guaranteed to go to the terminal state. That's a little bit weird, but it helps with the bookkeeping if you try to work an example by hand. All right, so at the moment I've done nothing, and my robot, who's now a blue dot, is in the lower left. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try to get to the upper right corner and get that plus one. And as I go, every time step, I'm going to receive a reward of minus 0.1. So it's a cost. So what I'm going to do, how should I get there? I'm going to go east. So I'm going to press the east key on my keyboard, which is the right key. And I don't actually know what will happen. Probably it will move east. Okay, so it did. Actually, let's look down here at the text output. It says I started in 0, 0, that's right. I took the action east, that's right. And I ended in state 1, 0. Okay, great. And I got the reward, -0.1. So that's my starting state, my action, and my ending state. Other ending states were possible, but that's the one I got this time. And then I got a reward along with it. So that's going to be really important. Every one of these transitions is a state, an action, a resulting state, and a reward. So I'm going to do it again. I'm going to press the east key. We'll see what happens. Okay. So it says, started in state 1, 0, took action east, ended in state 1, 0, got reward minus 0.1. So why didn't I move? Well, because 20% of the time, you don't actually go east, you either go north or south. And according to grid world rules, if either of those happens, you stay put, right? Because you can't go north or south. All right, so I got unlucky. I'm going to try east again. Okay, unexpected, but it can happen. Okay, I pressed east again, and now I finally move over into the square. You can see it's kind of annoying being in a grid world like this, because not everything that you try works out. But now I'm going to try to move north. Okay, now you got to cross your fingers as we pass the pit of death. I'm going to try north. Okay, that worked. Okay, I'm going to try north again. Something bad could happen here, right? I could fall into the pit. Okay, and that's that. Let's do that again. Live demos. Okay, let's try it again. East. What should I do now? Well, let's just, we had wanted to go east, but now that we're here, probably a better policy is to try to go north. So I'm going to try to go north. Okay, good. Now I'm going to go east again. East. East. I'm going to go east again, hopefully. Good. Okay, so I went into that east square. I'm going to now choose the action exit and receive my plus one. Okay, so somewhere up here in the text it says that I went from 3-2, I took the action exit, I ended in terminal state, I got my reward of plus 1, and my return, meaning the sum of my rewards, was 0.5. So it was plus 1, but I lost, every time step I lost a little bit. That's the way grid world works. Okay, so you can see things don't always go as expected, it's always exciting in grid world. And that's because this is a non-deterministic search problem. Now the question is, since you don't know what's going to happen, what does it even mean to solve these things? Well, first of all, you don't come up with a plan anymore, so we'll talk about what you do, but it's actually more like what we had for Expectimax, right? And so if you think that what this agent should do in this context is do an Expectimax search where all of the uncertainty and the action resolution is treated as a chance node, you're actually 90% of the way to solving MDPs. We'll have a new tool soon, but for now, one way to solve these things is with Expectimax. Okay, so this is Markov guy, and why is he in our search problem? So whenever we say Markov in this class, or really in any setting, we're talking about probabilities and things like that, Markov means that given some present state or information, the future and past are independent. Okay, what does that mean? In the case of a Markov decision process, Markov means that the action outcomes, that is what state you'll end up in when you take this action, of course it depends on your current state. Whether you fall into the pit of death depends on whether you're next to one, right? It also depends on your action, right? Some actions are riskier than others in a grid world. And so, of course, the outcome, the S prime you land in, depends on your state and action. The question is, does it depend on things that have gone before? Or or is your current state and action enough to completely determine the distribution, though not the outcome, of your transition? Okay, Markov here, if it's a Markov decision process, that means you're guaranteed that this giant conditional probability, which formally the S prime you end up in principle could depend on where you are, the action you've taken, and everything that came before that in this episode. But we're guaranteed that it only depends on the current state and action. That's what Markov gives us, right? The future, which is S prime, is independent of the past, which is all these T minus ones, given the present. We actually have seen this before. We saw this with search. So in search, you had a successor function, and it depended on your state. So the successors and the costs all depended on your state, but they didn't depend on your previous state. Your state somehow had to pack in all the information necessary to let the successor function do its job. And when you had problems in your homework, or as you'll see on exams, where you formulate a search problem, then you need to make sure the state encodes enough information to admit the successor function, because your history is gone, right? You don't keep your histories around. Same thing with MDPs. The state needs to support the successor function now. That means these conditional probabilities. Okay, bye-bye Markov. We'll see Markov again when we talk about hidden Markov model. Okay, so in single-agent deterministic search problems, we wanted a plan. That was a sequence of actions that take your start state and turn it into a goal state. That's totally off for MDPs. As we saw, you can plan to go east, but who knows what's going to happen. You might go north. You might end up in the pit of death. Right? And so we can't have a plan. What we can have instead is what's called a policy. And a policy, as we saw with games, is a recommendation function. It takes your state and it tells you what to do. Right? And so here you can see this treasure map that this robot agent is holding. That's a policy for this grid world we've been seeing, and it's a policy that's appropriate for a certain setting of the grid world, certain probabilities, certain living reward. In this case, this is where every step you lose 0.03 of a point. Right? And so it says if you're in this square, move north, or rather take the action north. If you're in this square, take the action east, and so on. So a policy gives an action for each state, which means explicitly if you wrote down a policy, you'd have a lookup table. Right? State, action, state, action, state, action. And that, of course, would be a reflex agent if you did it. Typically, you don't do that in large-scale problems because there are just so many states. And so very often, your policy is implicit. And your policy is, when you land in a state, run expectmax and do what it tells you. That's an implicit policy as opposed to a giant lookup table. Some policies are better than others. Obviously, a policy that always tells you to jump in the pit isn't a very good policy. And so we have a notion of not just a policy being kind of a lookup table, but there being better policies and worse policies. In particular, we want an optimal policy. An optimal policy is one that gives us the maximum expected utility of followed. Why does it say maximum expected utility? Why can't we just talk about the points you'll get if you follow a policy? Because you can still be unlucky, right? The policy can be great, and you might still have terrible luck, like apparently I do with demos today, right? And so the policy can't tell you how many points you're going to get. What you can say is you can say, if I follow this policy, on average or in expectation, here's the expected sum of rewards that I'll get. And so we're always now talking about not sums of costs. In the world of search, it was easy. You take your plan, you add up the 12 numbers, and that's your cost of your plan. Now, with MDPs, you have a policy. And so even thinking about how much it's going to cost involves thinking about many possible outcomes and taking sums over those outcomes. So even simple things like evaluating a policy are now a little harder. Okay, what's this have to do with expectmax, which I've said a couple times? Expectmax did not compute policies. When I run an expectmax search, what happens? I start doing a kind of Project 2 style search from a state, and of course I think about the future and there's an evaluation function and all that stuff, and at some point, what does expectmax return? It returns an action. It says, the expectmax value of the root is this, and you should go left. A policy would be a whole list of these things. So when you run expectmax, you're not computing a policy. You're computing one entry of a policy function. So if you wanted to compute a whole policy, you'd do a whole lot of expectmax. That's not going to be practical. Any questions on these basic ideas? MDPs, non-deterministic actions, policies, this kind of stuff. Okay, we're going to be building on these a lot. Let's take a look at some optimal policies for grid world. Okay. This is a grid world with 80% success rate, 10% kind of to left or right, and this is a grid world where it's +1 and -1 at the kind of at the gem and the pit of death, and also there's a living reward that's going to vary. So this particular grid world is the one where the living reward is -0.01. So a very small penalty each time step. Why does the time step penalty matter? Because it affects things like how, kind of whether or not you're willing to take the long way around. If there's heavy penalties, you might not be willing to take the time because time costs you. Okay, let's take a look at this one. So the living reward is very, the living penalty here is very small. And so let's look at what this policy says. It says if you're in square A here, what should you do? You should go west, right? That's not the shortest path. The shortest path is kind of to go head up this way, right? Why is it saying to go all the way around clockwise in order to get to the plus one? Right, this is safe. You've got a 10% chance of falling into any pit you pass, and here you just do a couple extra moves and you're kind of completely pit-free. Okay, so that makes sense. A is west. Now, what if you're in B? Remember, the policy has to tell you what to do from every state. And from B, it says, move west. What's west of you? The wall. So what's going to probably happen if you move west? Nothing. So what is, did it break? Did we compute the policy wrong? Why is the recommendation to move west? Yeah, right. If you move west, probably you'll stay put, but with 10% chance you'll either move north or south. And there's no risk of falling into the pit. This is like the robot pressing up against the ledge and just kind of shimmying left and right. That's what's going on with this wall. And so you're willing to like spend some time probably not making progress to get rid of the risk of falling into the pit. And whether or not you slip north or south doesn't really matter. From that point forward, you're pretty safe. Okay, so the reason why you're willing to go the long way and you're willing to kind of press yourself up into the wall and wiggle around until you happen to escape safely is because you have basically all the time in the world. The living penalty is very small. What happens if I change the reward? Well, as we know, we change the utility function and the behavior is supposed to change. The computations don't change, but the behavior should change. Okay. So here's a living reward that's slightly more painful. So what happens in A? You'll go the long way around. Okay. What about B? You no longer play that shimmy against the wall until you finally slip, right? And that kind of makes sense. It takes a long time before you actually move. That's pretty expensive, and so here you're not going to do that. Let's crank up the cost of each time step again and make the living reward even smaller. Okay. So here's minus 0.4. Let's look at the behavior. What happens here? So at A, it says take the shortest path, right? Maybe you'll fall in the pit, but it's just it's too painful to go the long way around. In fact, even here at C, now you don't want to go the long way around. You just want to kind of go in as few time steps as possible, and there's some 10% risk of a minus one, but really 10% risk of a minus one isn't so bad when you're losing 0.4 every time step. Okay, and so of course from B, you're going to move straight north. All right, what happens if I crank up the living reward to like minus two? What do you think will happen? What do you think? So at minus two, right, yeah, you want the plus one, you don't want the minus one, but really, you don't want the minus two. So you just like basically run for the nearest exit, right? And you can see here that as we change the utilities, the same set of computations give rise to different behavior, which is pretty cool. Okay, let's look at another MDP, which is very different. Because just like search, it's very easy to think that all search is about grids and mazes. It's not, and not all MDPs are grid worlds. So here's an example of a very simplified racing robot monitoring its own internal temperature. We have some robot car, and what we want it to do is travel far and quickly. Far means you don't want it to break down, and quickly means you would like it to kind of move fast. All right. So how might we formalize this? We could say there's three states of the car. It can be cool, this is an engine here, cool, it could be warm, or it could be overheated, right? You ran it too hot, and now the car's broken. So here's the three states. Cool, that's the happy car. Warm, kind of in a little bit of danger. And overheated means broken down. And we'll imagine from overheated, there's no coming back from overheated. Okay, so there's two actions. You can drive slow or fast. And of course, we could formalize this with more states or with continuous actions. But right now, we're taking this formulation. All right, so there's slow and there's fast. Slow, what do these do? Well, slow with probability one. So in fact, it's deterministic. When you're cool and you take the slow action, you remain cool. That makes sense. If you take the fast action when you're cool, half the time you remain cool, but half the time you warm up, and now you're in the warm state. Okay? That's a non-deterministic action. How about from warm? Maybe slow has a 50% chance of cooling you down and a 50% chance of keeping you warm. Okay, how about what happens if you drive fast from the warm state? Well, you're guaranteed to overheat. Okay, and so if you're overheated, that's kind of a terminal state. From that point forward, there are no rewards. And these are the probabilities. These are the actions that apply and what they do. And what we need to show now is not just the transition functions. So these 0.5s and 1s, these are the transition functions, T. Okay. What are the rewards? Well, we have to kind of say precisely what they are. So maybe going faster gets you double the reward, which means on whenever you go slow, you get a plus 1. And whenever you go fast, you get a plus 2, unless, of course, you overheat in the process, and then you'll get a minus 10, and the game will end. Okay, so there's a very small MDP. This is a little bit different than the other MDP, right? There's no x, y coordinates or anything like that. There's not that many states, but you can imagine this MDP going on forever, right? As long as you don't drive too fast, you can keep driving forever. So now we're going to have to start thinking about what happens if the MDP actually lasts forever. Okay, so any questions on this example? We're going to see it a lot. Okay, so let's think about a search tree. So if I said, all right, here's this MDP, the car is currently cool, what should you do? Well, looking at it, what should you do? You should go fast, because you'll always be able to kind of slow down if you happen to heat up. Okay, so you should go fast. How might you determine that? You might say, well, it's currently cool, and my choices are I can go fast or I can go slow. Right? Here, left is blue, which is going slow. Now, what happens if I go slow? Guaranteed to remain cool. All right, if I go fast, I have a 50-50 chance of either remaining cool or getting hot. And this should start to look familiar, right? Because if I think forward to the future, I'll have choices again from these points. And so, again, I'll have a choice at each of those possible outcomes between fast or slow, and then some chance node will take over and determine what happens. And you can see if I go fast and I go fast and I'm unlucky, then I might overheat. Okay, so presumably if I crunch the numbers and in this, I should go fast and then at that point probably slow down. Okay, so that's a search tree. What does this look like? This is an expect-a-max tree. There's max nodes, except they're shaped like cars, and there's chance nodes, and they even look like circles. Okay, there's only one difference between expect-a-max, as we learned in the last lecture, and this tree, right? And that is, where are the rewards in an expect-a-max tree? A game. They're all at the end. When the game ends, you have some score, or you win or you lose, and everything in between is kind of a propagated up from the bottom. Here, there are actually, you know, rewards as you go. So when I choose to go slow, I get a plus 1. If I choose to go fast, I get a plus 2. And the rewards are kind of spread throughout the tree. So there'll have to be some minor bookkeeping to deal with the fact that the rewards come in step by step. Beyond that, it's expect-a-max. So you can think in your head that from any state, the futures you might experience in an MDP, they look like expect-a-max. And every algorithm, even though in general we're not going to be using expect-a-max to solve these, every algorithm at its core is expect-a-max, or kind of is derived from the same kinds of thinking that gives rise to expect-a-max. So I hope you like expect-a-max. There's going to be a lot of expect-a-max. Each MDP state is going to project a kind of a search tree. We know what states are, okay? So a state here is the current situation of the world, and that's something like, I'm in this square. Okay, so states, we know them and we love them. What happens in a state when you take an action? You control the action. So if you take the action in some sense, you've pushed the button on going north. You don't know whether you're going to fall into the pit or not, right? Or you're going to stay put or you're going to slip or whatever. Okay, but you were in a state and you've committed to an action. You're waiting to see how it resolves. And in essence, you've made your move, and the world's going to make its move next and tell you what happens. Okay, that state of having been in a state S and committing to an action A but being uncertain what's going to happen, this is called a Q state. This is probably the single most important and confusing piece of notation we're going to see today. And a Q state is a pair of a state and an action, and you can see in the illustration here, you're in a state, you've committed to moving, in this case, to the east, but you don't know what's going to happen. Okay, so you move from a state to a Q state, SA, using a max node, right? You pick the action. Then you move from a Q state, SA, to a result state, S prime. That's the world. It's telling you, it's telling you what's going to happen. So we've got some terminology down here. So you pick an S, B the environment picks an S prime, this pair, sorry, this SA along with the result S prime, so this triple here, SAS prime, this thing is called a transition, right? It's a state, it's an action that you chose, and it's a response from the world. That's called a transition. The probability of the transition comes from T, and the reward associated with the transition, which could be zero, comes from the function R. Any questions on that? All the algorithms are going to manipulate these quantities to kind of compute various sums and maxes. Okay, before we start solving these, let's actually think a little bit about something that I've been sweeping under the rug so far. And that is, the MDP defines rewards. So this transition gives you a plus one, this one gives you a minus one. Which means when you have a sequence of actions and you experience a whole grid world or a racing robot, you get plus ones and minus ones and plus 0.3s and whatever it is, we've been adding them up. Who says that you should add up your rewards? Okay, so now we need to think a little bit about, we know we're going to get a sequence of utilities. What should our preferences be over, say, for example, getting the rewards sooner rather than later? So what preferences should our agent have over sequences of rewards? Well, let's start with an easy question. Would you like more rewards or less rewards? It seems reasonable that the agent would like more rewards, otherwise we got our signs wrong. So for example, if my choice were between the reward sequence 1, 2, 2, or 2, 3, 4, what should I prefer? Right. I should prefer the one that has bigger numbers. Okay, that's easy. Adding them up satisfies this. Right? If you add them up, then you prefer things that are more. However, how about now versus later? So what would you rather have if you were an agent? Would you rather have the reward sequence 001 or the reward sequence 100? Or maybe you're indifferent. A. B. Who prefers A? Who prefers B? Who's indifferent? Okay. By the way, totally reasonable to be indifferent, and it's also reasonable to prefer for B, right? Somebody says, what would you rather have? Would you rather have $1,000 right now or in 6 years? Well, like, it seems reasonable to prefer it now, right? So it's totally fine to maximize the sum of rewards. Sometimes that's an appropriate formulation of your utilities. It's also reasonable to prefer things now rather than later. But if you do that, there's now a trade-off. Maybe you'd rather have 900 now than 900 later, but would you rather have 900 now than 1,000 later? Who knows? This depends on the details of your preference function. So one solution that captures this idea that rewards are worth more now than later is when you consider their value in terms of utilities, you take the reward itself and somehow discount it for being in the future. And so you can do this by an exponential decay. This is the standard method. You say, if I get to that gem, it's worth one if it happens in this time step. But if it happens in the next time step, it's worth less. How much less? Let's say gamma. Gamma will be some number, which is called a discount. And it'll be something between 0 and 1. What happens if I don't get this gem for two time steps? Well, I'll get my discount twice, so it'll be worth gamma squared. And if I get it kind of infinitely far in the future, its value will tend towards 0, right? And that seems reasonable, too. So this is called discounting. Okay, so first let's talk about how you might deal with discounting, and then we'll talk about why we do it and kind of think about it a little more formally. So mechanically, if you think about this tree of possible futures, remember you get rewards at every level. Now, in grid world, all the big ones are at the end for small values of the living reward, but in the car racing, you kind of get plus ones and minus ones as you go. Right? So there's rewards at every level, and we are going to add them up. But what we do is, to the extent that you think about this as a kind of recursive search, every time you move down a level into the tree, you get a factor of gamma, which is less than 1, that makes your rewards worth less and less. And once you pick up too many factors of gamma, the rewards, whether they were good or bad, they've been kind of pushed towards 0. So why should we do this? Well, one reason to do this is it probably is the case that rewards sooner should have higher utility. So you all said most of you would prefer to have the rewards sooner rather than later in the example, and this gives you that. When gamma is like 0.9999, you kind of don't really care about today versus tomorrow. But when gamma is 0.001, it's worth full price today and basically nothing tomorrow. So what you set gamma to changes what's called your horizon, how far out the rewards are important to you. It also turns out that a lot of the algorithms just kind of converge better if the distant future doesn't matter. When the distant future matters, you're kind of forced to think about it, and that has a computational cost. Okay, so let's do an example. Let's say your discount is 0.5. So every time step in the future that your reward comes, it's worth half as much to you. So if I think about the utility sequence 1, 2, 3, the sum of utilities is 6, but the sum of discounted utilities is 1 for the first reward because it gets full value. The second reward is a 2, but it's only worth half as much because it's coming one step in the future. And the third reward is coming two steps in the future, so it's only worth a quarter as much. So you add all of those up, and what you get is you get that now the utility of 1, 2, 3 is less than the utility of 3, 2, 1. Their sum is the same, but their discounted sum is going to be different. So now we've got two techniques for turning sequences of rewards into utilities. You might then wonder, you know, so adding them up, that was intuitive. Discounting, that's a little weird. Why was it exponential? Maybe there's 17 other things that are all reasonable. And actually, there are a lot of preference functions that would count as rational, but there's a kind of preference function that we call stationary. What is a stationary preference function? A stationary preference function says, essentially, that whatever I prefer today, I prefer tomorrow. Okay? So if we assume stationary preferences, which formally mean if I prefer one sequence, A1, A2, A3, and so on, to another sequence, B1, B2. So I like the A sequence better than the B sequence. If I take those same sequences, I push them one step in the future, and I give them R in the first step, so the same. These are two sequences that are the same in the first step, and then I like A better than B, I should preserve my preferences, right? Shifting things into the future, but otherwise keeping them identical, shouldn't change my orderings. Okay. If that's true, we say your preferences are stationary. Is it possible to have non-stationary preferences? Absolutely. But if you have stationary preferences, then you have a theorem that tells you there's only two ways to define utilities that work out. One is additive utilities, and the other is adding discounted utilities. And in fact, if you let gamma be 1, you get additive utilities. So there's really only one thing you can do. Because of this, all of the solution that we do from this point forward is going to be in terms of discounted utilities, and you can always set gamma equal to 1 if you just want to add them up. That means that in all our equations going forward, there's going to be these gammas floating around. And that's what they mean. It means every time I take a time step into the future, whatever happens gets deflated by a factor of gamma. Any questions on this? Yes. Good question. If you assume your preferences are stationary, then you essentially can derive that your utility function, remember, utilities are numbers that express preferences. You can prove that you have to have one of these utility formulations. It doesn't mean your preferences have to be stationary. So there are cases, for example, say if you're playing a game that ends at a certain time, like life. Life ends at a certain time. We don't always know when, but it doesn't go on forever. And so your utilities in life aren't stationary. The things you want today may not be the same preference functions you have in 10 years. And that's because you can't just shift things in the future because they kind of scroll up the end, right? And because of that, there are very reasonable cases where stationary preferences is not a reasonable assumption. But when they're stationary, you kind of can derive that they have to be sums of discounted. Any other questions? Oh, yeah, sorry. Sure. Preferences are called stationary if they obey the following thing. So I say, here's one sequence, we can call it capital A, and here's another sequence, capital B, right? If I prefer, that looks a lot like an A, doesn't it? Okay, capital A and capital B. If I prefer capital A to capital B, which is fine, they're different sequences, what should happen if I take those sequences and I create new sequences, which are essentially R, some fixed number, followed by A, and this one's R followed by B. So it seems like if A is better than B now, which is up here, A should be better than B one step in the future, assuming that first step is identical. Okay, if that holds, you say your preferences are stationary, but your preferences may not be stationary. Okay. So now we have a problem, we alluded to it, but we're going to talk about it now, which is what happens if your game lasts forever, right? Life may not last forever, but these mathematical games can. And does that mean you get infinite rewards? If that car drives forever, does that mean it's just kind of fast, slow? It doesn't matter. You're going to get infinity eventually. right? You could see how there might be a problem for infinite games if kind of good and bad policies all give rise to infinity eventually. And now, who cares what you do in the short term? So we need something to deal with these things that last forever. And there's really two solutions, two major solutions, but there's a couple ways these can fall out. So one solution is finite horizon. So this is a case where the game is in fact finite, okay? So if the game ends after a limited number of time steps, it's kind of like depth-limited search. The game goes and goes and goes. After 20 time steps, it's just done. This is like grid world with like a countdown to the end of the world, okay? In that case, it's finite. And in fact, you won't get you won't get stationary policies. The action you take is going to depend on the amount of time that's left. And that means that things are going to end after some fixed time, which will be like life is like this. Okay, there's another solution, which is your game could be finite, then you don't have to worry about infinities. Or your game could be infinite. Okay, and when it's infinite, there's really two ways, again, that things can work out okay. One is discount. So luckily, we already have the major solution. If you set your discount between 0 and 1, then even if your utility sequence of R's, the rewards at the time steps, even if you get an infinite number of rewards, their sum is going to be bounded, assuming that the rewards themselves are bounded, right? And essentially now this is just about the math of infinite series. If you have this exponential decay, then when you add everything up, you're fine, at least if the rewards themselves are bounded above and below. What does gamma mean here? If gamma is 0, only the next time step matters, because after that, everything's worthless. If gamma is 1, then you have infinite horizon. And so gamma in between is going to determine kind of how far into the future the rewards matter, and in a kind of a soft way. Okay, there's actually another way to do it, which is to have a guarantee that no matter what your policy is, a terminal state will eventually be reached with probability 1. So for example, in the racing case, if there was always some chance to overheat, even though, in principle, you could have an infinite run of not overheating, with probability 1, you will eventually overheat. And that means that when you average things together, it'll kind of work out. It's something actually like having your game be finite in a soft way. Sooner or later, the odds are going to go against you and the game's going to end. Even if there are infinite sequences, they have infinitely small weights. Not because of the discounting, but because their probability goes to 0. Okay, so that's what we do about infinite utilities. Any questions about that? Okay, so let's see where we are. Actually, let's take a break right now, and then we'll talk about algorithms for solving MDPs that have properties better than expectamax. Take a couple-minute break now. Okay, let's get started again. Okay, so all of that, everything we just did, was about defining Markov decision processes and seeing examples of them and starting to talk about some of the notation for transition probabilities, rewards, and things like that. Now that we have some intuition about what an MDP is, let's talk about algorithms for solving them. Okay, so let's recap. What's an MDP? It's like a search problem, so it's got a set of states, including a start state. It's got a set of actions. And then it's got a successor function, and the successor function is composed of a transition function, which tells you from each state how likely each outcome is, and a reward function, which tells you for each state, action, result, state, S prime, how much that costs or what the reward is. In addition, an MDP has a discount, which tells you something about how long your horizon is as far as the rewards go. So what are the quantities we've talked about? Right. We've talked about a policy, which mathematically is a map from states to actions. And we've been talking about utilities, right? And we haven't been totally precise about about what computations we're going to do with these utilities, but we know that for a single sequence of rewards, the utility we're associating with it is going to be the sum of discounted rewards, and that comes from a stationarity assumption. Okay, so we know the utility for a sequence of actions, and we know what a policy is. There's a lot of other things we need to compute, and computing things like what is the best policy or how good is this state, that's going to be the subject for the algorithms we're going to be looking at for the next lecture and a half. So first let's talk about some what it means to solve, and then some new algorithms that effectively are going to take the ideas of expectamax but save us a lot of work. So let's talk about some quantities beyond policies and returns. One important kind of the central thing that you compute with MDP algorithms is what's called the value of a state, or the value of multiple states. So the value of a state, V stands for value here, the star indicates optimality, right? And so what the value function is it takes a state and it returns a utility. But what utility? This is the expected utility if you start in S and act optimally. The reason why there has to be that optimally in there is because from a state you could do dumb things, right? If you're next to the pit of death, you could jump into the pit of death. That's a bad policy, and so the values will be very low. A good policy might have very high values. And so when we talk about the value of a state, we either need to say what policy we're talking about, and we'll come to that later, or we need to say this is the value under optimal play, which then implicitly we're talking about an optimal policy. Okay, so V of S is the expected utility starting in S and acting optimally. Similarly, when we talk about a Q state, which is a state action pair, we say the value is the expected utility starting in that Q state, which means you were in action S, you committed to action A, which might have been a bad idea, but that's irrelevant, and from that point forward, you act optimally. Okay, so we have values of states and values of Q states, and we also have this notion of an optimal policy. So if we look at this on as expectamax, we would say, okay, if I'm in a state here, and I think about the whole expectamax tree, and it'd be inefficient to compute, but let's just conceptually imagine. If I computed the expectamax value of this state, then what I would get is I would get V, right? So if we start an expectamax computation from a state, the answer is the value of that state, which takes into account averages by averaging over the chance node. That's the expectation part. And it also takes into account optimality because expectamax only considers the best action at every max node. So if we start an expectamax that has to get into that, right? If we start an expectamax at a chance node, we'll get another value. Okay, so even though it's kind of hard to get intuition about what a Q state is, and you might forget it, the key thing is when you do expectamax, it returns a value for a state and for chance nodes. The value of a chance node with expectamax is the Q value. Okay, so let's see some examples of these. I think I want this one. Okay, so this, by the way, these grids with numbers in them, this is your this is the first half of your project threes. Okay, so for this grid world, what am I looking at? This is a grid world that has the standard grid world movement, you know, rules, 10% noise in each direction, that kind of thing. It's also got some discount, and it's also got some living reward for each time step. So what are these numbers we see? Well, some of the numbers are pretty interpretable. So for example, in this square here, we see a 1. What does that mean? In that square, if you act optimally, which involves choosing the action exit, right, there's nothing else you can do, you're going to get a 1 every time. So that is the expected utility from starting in that state. How about right here? If you're in the pit of death, the only thing you can choose is the action exit, and you get a minus 1. But what's this 0.85? This 0.85 here is the average score you're going to get if you act optimally, which in this case, you can see, you can guess that these arrows are the optimal policy, means trying to go east. What's going to happen? Well, maybe you'll go east and then you'll exit. Or maybe you'll slip and you'll go to the south. And at that point, you'll then try to go north, which maybe will result in going north, or maybe you'll fall into the pit, and so on. So this 0.85 rolls all of that up. You could think of this 0.85 as being the expectamax value, like if you run expectamax from the state. You could also think about it as somebody handed you the optimal policy and said, what will happen on average if I follow this policy? And then, of course, there's exponentially many things that might happen, but if you added them up weighted by their probabilities, you would get 0.85. Both of those computations are equivalent. Okay, let's see what else we can see here. Down here, 0.28, this is the worst square in terms of value. Why? Why is this so bad? Well, one, you might fall straight into the pit. Two, even if you kind of make it to the good reward, it's going to take a while. So it's both the fact that you've got kind of some short-term bad outcomes under this policy, and the fact that that living reward is slowly chipping away at your value. This is not a good square to be in. Now, of course, even bad squares to be in have optimal actions to take. The value doesn't tell you what to do. It just tells you what your average score is going to be if you start there. So if somebody gave you the choice, you wouldn't want to start here. If you're there, what does the value do? Well, it doesn't really do anything. It's a quantity that you compute along the way when trying to figure out what you should do, which in this case is move left. So it's just like a minimax value, right? If the minimax value is high or low, you know, that's kind of how good the world is. It doesn't tell you how to act. And so these are the values, and we'll talk about how to compute them. What does a Q value look like? Well, let's take a specific example so we can see. Okay, how about here? This is a good example. This 0.28. Its value is 0.28. If you think about the expectomax, we're in the state. What could we do? We could go east, we could go west, we could go north, we could go south. Apparently, when you kind of chug all the computations, going west is the right thing to do. What's probably the worst thing to do? North is probably the worst action. So going up is a bad idea, and you're probably going to end up with something like -1 if you go up. If you go west, then you're going to end up apparently with 0.28. If we break out not just the value of the state, which is the value of acting optimally from this state, right, best action, and we fix the action, then suddenly this state now has four different numbers. These four numbers are the values, right? Remember, expectomax value. If you commit to that action, but thereafter act optimally, right? So you can see, for example, if you commit to north, but then act optimally, well, what are you going to do? You're going to lose a living reward. There's going to be some discount. Then you're going to end the game. So the Q value for this Q state is low, but the Q value for this Q state is reasonable. It's 0.28. It's not a coincidence that one of these Q values equals the value, because the value is just a max over all of the actions you can take. Meaning it's going to be, the value is going to be the maximum of one of the Q values. Any questions on that? It's kind of visualizing some of these values. We'll see some other values later. So, values of states. This is a fundamental operation we need an algorithm for. This algorithm is going to compute the expectomax value of a state. That's the expected utility under optimal action. That means it's going to be an average sum of discounted rewards with kind of the appropriate actions taken at every place. And it's what expectomax computed. So if I say, here's an MDP, go compute me the values, what you could do is you could say, okay, wait a minute. You could go state by state, and for each one, you could launch a little expectomax and use it to compute the value. This would work. There's actually two problems with it. Why would you not compute the values of all the states by running lots of expectomax? One problem is there might be a lot of states. You're going to have to run expectomax over and over, and surely there's going to be some redundant work. Okay. Secondly is, if you'll remember, these games can last forever. Expectomax is exponential in its depth. And so what happens if you set the depth to infinite? Bad news, right? So even a single expectomax won't work in an infinite game, and even if you somehow had a way to do that, there would be a lot of wasted work between the different states because they share a lot of structure. So instead, what we're going to do is we're going to write down a recursive definition that captures what expectomax does, but then we're going to reorganize the computation in a bottom-up way so that we don't waste work. Okay, so what's the definition of value? Let's actually write this out. Let's talk about a state. So if I want to say, what is the value of a state? Right, so that's V star of some state S. Well, we think back to what would expectomax do on this tree. Expectomax would say, well, the score you're going to get from that state depends on which action you take. And you should take the action that gives you the biggest score. How would you do this? If you actually implement your project too, how do you implement this? Well, you loop over the children, and for each one you recurse, right? So how do we write that in an equation? We say the value of a state is looping over the children and taking the max. We write with a max. Okay, and then we recurse. Well, we recurse in the code to a chance node, and that here is a Q value. So it's the maximum of all of the chance nodes, which are Q states SA. It's the best one. So this equation here, even though it's got this Q that you're still building intuitions for, this just says it's the maximum of the children. Easy, right? Max nodes are simple. What is the expect-a-max value? What would expect-a-max return from a queue state, from a chance node? Well, you can think about that. You're at this green node here, and you're doing expect-a-max. So what does expect-a-max do? It visits all of the children. It recurses to that child to see how good that child is, and then it averages them together, right? So how would we write that? Well, we have to visit all of the children. So we're going to go to each one of these children, S prime, and we're going to compute its value. So that's some function call to V star of S prime. Okay, so we compute all the children's values, and then we average them. Well, what does that mean now? Let me move this over here. What is the probability that this particular S prime is going to happen? Right, it's given by the problem. And what is it? It's the transition function. Good. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to do an average. For each S prime, we're going to look at how likely it is according to the transition function, and we're going to add those up. So we're going to add up over all S primes, transition function, times value of the child. If it were like this, it would be just like expect-a-max. This is max would be a V would be a max over the children, and Q would be an average over the children. But remember, there's one more change between expect-a-max and an MDP, and that is you get rewards at every step. And so when you go from S to A to S prime, in addition to having a probability of this outcome, and in addition to having a future value of V star, you have an instantaneous reward. So at that very instant, you get the reward RS. A S prime. Okay, so you have to average over the possible S primes. For each one, you look at the instantaneous reward plus the future reward, where the future reward comes from this recursion. And if you remember, there's one more thing, which is that there's a gamma that discounts the future by a factor of gamma every time step into the future. And because S prime is one time step into the future, I get one gamma. So this is it. Okay, here's your occurrence for max. Here's your occurrence for the average, and it's a little bit complicated by this fact that there's instantaneous rewards along the way. Yes? You're going to average over S prime, why not divide it by S prime? S prime is not a number. You mean divide it by the number of S primes? Yeah, so that's already in T. So if there are two S primes that are possible, each one will be 0.5 if they're equally likely. So T already is a normalized probability distribution. Okay. So I'm going to, any questions on this before I replace it with nice pretty LaTeX instead of my handwriting? Okay, so the value is a max node. It's defined in terms of a chance node. The chance node is defined in terms of the max nodes with an expectation, just like expect a max, and reward plus discounted future. Okay, that's breaking your future up into what happens in the next time step and then a recursive call. You can kind of inline this, and you can write this without any queues. So if queues offend you, you can write this equation that says V star of S is a function of other V stars of S. Okay, now, this equation is actually the standard form. This is something called a Bellman equation. We'll talk about this later. But it's kind of an eye fool, right? So if you look at this, you know, your chance of symbol shock is high. So what you want to do whenever you think about this is you want to think, when I see a max, that's this for loop here, the for loop that loops over all the children. And when I see a sum that's weighted by t, that's looping over the possible outcomes of the chance node. And so if I want to go from a state to another state, I need to consider my action, which is the max over actions, and the outcome s prime, which is an expectation. Okay. So we're going to see a bunch of variants of these things. They're unfortunately going to look a little similar, but the reason they look similar is because it's that same expect-a-max calculation over and over again. And in some sense, it's often easier to be able to reconstruct these from expect-a-max than to memorize them, because again, they're pretty similar. Okay, let's look at the search tree. So what I just wrote here, these equations, these are definitions. This is not an algorithm, right? Because they're the same variables on the left-hand side and right-hand side, and that means if I executed this as a recurrence, there's no guarantee it would ever terminate. And in fact, for the car problem, it wouldn't terminate. So this isn't an algorithm. But let's think about what the racing search tree actually looks like. Okay, so at the root, we've got the current state, right? Underneath that, we've got two queue states that correspond to the two actions we could commit to, and those states have kind of one or more resolutions, and then we're back to states. So here's the racing search tree. We could run Xpactomax on it. We couldn't run it to infinite depth because this game goes on forever, but there you go. Let's go down a couple more levels. The search tree is starting to get kind of, the branching factor is not that great, but if you go down deep enough, there start to be a lot of states. Okay, but how many states are there in this problem? There's three. But in some sense, it's crazy that we've got a search tree that's getting exponentially large when we've only got three states in our problem. And so there's a lot of repeated work, right? If you think about executing Xpactomax from here, right, versus from here, right, it's the same Xpactomax computation. So one thing that's wrong about computing Xpactomax from a tree like this is because if the states repeat, you end up redoing their Xpactomax computation. So at one level, you could say, we could just fix this. We could just kind of hack a fix into this. We could do some memoization and say, if you ever ask me a question I've computed before, I'm just going to return the answer. And actually, that would be fine. That's 90% of the algorithm that we're going to do. We're going to do Xpactomax, but we're going to avoid doing computation, except we're going to organize it differently. Okay, let's look at the search tree. We're doing way too much work with Xpactomax because the same states are reappearing. And so instead, what we're going to do is we're going to compute the quantities we need once. But rather than just let kind of memoization start this out on the fly, we're going to write down all the quantities that we're ever going to need, and then we're going to compute them one by one. In essence, what we're going to do is rather than starting at the top and working downward, we're going to start at the bottom and work up in a dynamic program. Okay. So, and the tree might be infinite, and that would be bad. So we'll talk about how we fix that later. But first, let's just deal with this repeated work issue. The key idea behind this algorithm we're going to see, and the algorithm we're going to see is going to be called value iteration. The key idea is called time-limited values. So you can think you have a stopwatch that has k more time steps, and then the world's going to end. Okay. So why is this good? Well, if there's only one time step, computing values is easy. You don't have to think about the future at all. When there's two time steps, it's not that hard. Right, and so what you can do is you can imagine just doing kind of deeper and deeper computation. So we're going to define v sub k of a state. So remember, v is the value under optimal play, s is a state, and we're going to define v sub k to be the optimal value if the game is going to end in k steps. Okay. Equivalently, it's what depth k Xpactomax would give, because in Xpactomax you consider kind of k layers and then silence, right? So if we computed this, right, this is that search tree, if we computed this, this is a depth 2 Xpactomax, and we would say the result of that computation is v2 of the root state, which in this case is cool. Okay? So what we're going to do is we're basically going to compute all the v1s and all the v2s and so on, so that we don't have to repeat any of those computations. Let's actually look at what we're computing before we see how to compute them. So here are depth-limited values for the grid. Right? Remember, some of them were green, some of them were red. Now they're all black. They're all zero. So what depth is this? This is zero. This is the value you're going to get. That is the Xpactomax score under optimal play if you have exactly zero time steps left, meaning nothing will happen. What if we have one time step left? Well, if we're in the good exit up here in the upper right, what will our average score be in one time step? It'll be plus one, and it will always be plus one because there's only one thing that can happen. Similarly, if you're in the pit of death, then your average reward or your Xpactomax value will be plus one. How about if you're right here? You're right next, you're one step west of the good reward. What can happen to you in one step? Well, you can get to the good square, but you can't exit. So you'll still have zero if there's zero living reward. So in this case, I set the living reward to zero. In one time step, you can see the only squares in which you'll see a reward are the squares that are one step exit away. In two steps, where can I see a reward? Well, if I'm right here next to the good exit, in two time steps, I can move to the east, and then I can exit. But if I'm over here at the start, in two time steps, I still can't get to any non-zero reward. So if I go to values v2, these are the optimal values in two time steps. Now, that 0.79 there, that actually has two components. There's two reasons why it's less than one. One is any living reward that might be in play, although here the living reward is zero. a discount, if a discount is in play, and also the fact that even though you can get a plus one in two time steps, you might not, because you might slip. Okay, so if I go three time steps, you can see that 0.79 has gone up to 0.87. And you can see if I go to four time steps, then five time steps, then six, the longer my horizon is in my search, meaning V sub K for larger K, the farther away from the end state I can start to see rewards. Yes? Why do the lower... Okay, so right now, we're talking about the lower right. In one time step, what's the best you can do?
Right.
Zero. In two time steps, the best you can do is zero. Three time steps, the best you can do is zero. And in four time steps, what can I accomplish? I can move to here, to here, to here, to here. So that's one, two, three, four, and then that's it. I need a fifth time step to take the exit action and receive my plus one. It does have a score and it scores zero. That's right. If I reran this with a living reward, there'd be kind of minus 0.4s everywhere. But you can see how kind of the information propagates out as the depth increases, and here's what it will converge to. If you look at this, you can actually see what's going on. You can see that there is a discount, and it's a very small, sorry, the discount is very near one. Okay. So let's think about how to compute those. Well, computing them actually turns out to be pretty easy, at least for V0. Because in V0, you're at the bottom of the tree. You have zero rewards left to come. Zero time steps means zero rewards to sum up. So V0 is easy, it's all zeros. And we can compute V0 for each of our three states. There aren't that many states, so it's easy to do. How about V1? Well, if you think about this, this tree may be very large, but there's only three states. And so the vectors of values that I can get at this level of the tree, there's only three numbers. They just keep reoccurring. Similarly, if I go up here, I can compute V2. Those are expected max searches of depth 2. And again, there's only three to compute. There's only three to compute at this layer, and there's three to compute at the root. Okay, there's actually more work at the root, but this way I'll get the answer for all states. So how do I compute these? Well, it can be like building a cake. You start at the bottom. And so you start at the bottom with V0. And presumably that's not good enough for you, so you compute V1. Presumably that's not good, you compute V2. And at some point around V100, you say these are good enough, I'm going to stop. Let's see how that workflow goes. There's an algorithm called value iteration. You start with V0, which is always 0. Okay. So unlike expectmax, where at the bottom there are all the good numbers, right, in a game, the bottom is zeros. When the game ends, it's done. There's no more rewards. You were kind of handed your rewards step by step. So V0 is by definition 0. And that's not a single number, that's a vector. There's one of these Vs for every state. It's a vector for each state. It's a vector containing an entry for each state. Okay, then I give you some current V whatever. So at the moment you've only got V0, but at some point you will have computed V7. When it's time to compute V10, you've got V9 sitting there waiting. In essence, when you compute V10, you've already done the depth 9 expectmax values, though you've done them in this value iteration way. So what do? When it's time to compute VK plus 1, I think, well, what is this thing? What is VK plus 1? It is the answer of an expectmax search of depth K plus 1. Well, how would I do it? Well, here's my expectmax tree. So for this state, VK plus 1 involves, right, I need to loop over all of my actions A and pick the best one, just like expectmax. That's this max right here. For each action A, I need to consider all of the S primes that might result. And here, this is the loop over the actions S prime. I consider all the S primes that are possible, and then I average them together based on T, their relative probabilities. For each of these actions, and for each of the S primes that can result, I add together my instantaneous reward, and then my future, which is a recursive call. Now, of course, it's not really a recursive call, because I've already computed VK. That's the way this algorithm works. So what I end up doing is to compute the K plus 1 depth expectmax, I actually only do depth 1 expectmax, right? Because once I go down a single layer, my truncation function has already been computed for me. So you can see that over here in the street. To compute K plus 1 value, I go one layer, and then I
decay from previous computation. And that's it. You repeat that until convergence. Any question on this before we talk about convergence for a little bit? Okay, so V0 is easy. You compute V1 from V0, V2 from V1, and so on. Okay. How long does this take? Well, you don't necessarily know how many iterations you're going to do, so there's some amount of work per iteration. But for each iteration, what do? You do a loop over the actions, right? That's here. So you get a factor of A. You have to try every action from this state. Then you're going to iterate over the S primes, the possible outcomes. Okay, so there's a factor of A for maxing over all the A. There's a factor of capital S, number of states, because you're looping over all the states to take the average. And you have to do this computation for every state over here. So when you compute VK plus 1, it's not for one state, it's for all the states. So there's a factor of S over here. So this whole thing is S squared A. In practice, it's not that bad, because usually when you take this expectation, there's only a small number of states that are possible. But in the generic case, this is quadratic in the number of states, which means this is only going to work if there's a small number of states, and linear in the number of actions. So, what do you guarantee? There's a theorem that says this will converge to unique optimal values under some fine print. Okay, the basic idea is that as you do iteration after iteration, they start off all zero and they end up at the right answer, and they get closer and closer to the right answer every iteration. Now I'm going to show you something in a demo for a second that will make this last bullet clear about the policy converging long before the values do. But let's first just talk a little bit about an example, and then we'll talk about convergence, and then I'll show you about this issue from that bullet point about policy. Policy is converging faster. Okay, so V0, let's do a value iteration computation. Here are my three states up here. Let's compute V0. Easy. 0, 0, 0. That happens to be the score I would get on average acting optimally over zero time steps, but it's just zero. Let's talk about V1. V1 for each state involves a tiny little expectimax that says, what can my score be if I have one step left? So let's do an easy one. If I'm overheated, zero. You can never get points again from the overheated state. Let's talk about the red state, warm. Well, what can I do in one step from warm? I can go fast and get a minus 10, or I can go slow and get a plus 1. So 1 is what I should do. That's my expected max value of depth 1 from red. How about blue? What can I do? I can go fast and get a plus 2, or I can go slow and get a plus 1. So from blue, I should go fast and get 2. Nothing's interesting until this next level. The next level is kind of interesting. Except not here, because it's just zero again from overheated. Let's think about the red state. So we're going to compute this number right now. Okay. What's this computation look like? It's a depth 1 expectimax, where when I think about the future, I plug in V1. So how does this computation go? Well, I have to consider both of my possible actions, which are fast and slow. Let's think about slow first. If I go slow from the red state, what am I going to get? Well, there's a 50% chance that I'm going to get a plus 1 and then land back at the red state. If that happens, what's my total score going to be, assuming there's no discount here? Plus 1, and then I'm going to land, and then I'm going to act for one more time step so I get to there. So 1 and 1, which is 2. So one possibility is I could go fast, and then I would get a 2. Sorry, slow. The other possibility is I could go fast. What happens if I go fast? Sorry, I broke this. Let's try that again. So in this computation, there's two options, right? From red, there's fast, which is bad, right? We know going fast is going to be bad. Because if I go fast, what is my score over the next two time steps? It's negative 10. I get a negative 10 and the game ends. So if I go fast, it's going to be minus 10. So that's probably not going to be the number for V2. What happens if I go slow? If I go slow, there's two possible outcomes of going slow. One is I end up at warm, and one is I end up at cool. Either way, I get a plus 1 immediately. The difference is, if I land at cool, then I'm going to have a value of 2 in the next time step. That's this number. If I land at warm, then I'm going to have a value of 1 in the next time step. So in the future, I'm going to get the average of those, so 1.5. That means that I should choose slow for V2, and the sum is going to be 2.5. So if I erase the work table, the sum here is going to be 2.5. And if I work that out here as well, I'll get 3.5. And so, it's not really a 0.5, is it? 3.5 And I can keep doing this. And as I go higher and higher up, what are these going to converge to? What is V sub 100 of cool? It's like, is it like 6 or is it like 100? It's going to be like 100, right? Because if I don't do anything wrong, I can kind of play this game forever. So these values, in fact, aren't going to converge. All right, but that's how you compute them. I'm going to quickly say why these things converge. Oh, we're kind of out of time. Okay, then I'm not going to tell you why they converge. Instead, I'm going to show you. Yeah, no, I'm not going to show you anything. I'll show you next time. We'll pick this up next time.